In this lesson, we're going to talk a little bit about different methods that we use to sample populations, and we're going to discuss the central limit theorem. We'll also learn about sampling errors. Whether it be the government, or in business, or even social sciences, typically we don't survey an entire population. We look at a sample. Now, an example of a survey of the entire population would be the census, and you get an idea of, you know, how long and drawn out and expensive that actually is. And that's why we don't actually do that too much within research. So one reason that we don't contact or survey the whole population, it's very, very time consuming. It could be very cost prohibitive to do that. Might be impossible to catch every item in a population, and it also might be destructive. For instance, if you were working for a bullet manufacturer and you wanted to sample every bullet that you produced to see if it fired, well, obviously that would destroy the bullet, so you couldn't do a population. You would have to do a sample. So in most cases, we're going to learn that the sample actually is adequate, and we're going to learn that the sample is an estimate of the population, and it's an unbiased and usually fairly accurate estimate of the population. The most commonly used and preferred method of sampling is called probability sampling, and in probability sampling, every member of the population has an equal likelihood of being studied. So for instance, let's say the population is 2. If you flip a coin to choose which individual to sample, that would be an example of probability sampling. And we'll talk about some different methods of probability sampling as we continue on. One of the most common methods of probability sampling is called simple random sampling. And in simple random sampling, again, every person in the population has an equal chance of being included. And there's a couple of methods that we use to do that, and we'll describe these here in the next couple of slides. One very simple method to do a simple random sampling would be to use a table of random numbers. And you'll find one of these in your textbook. You could also generate one with Excel here. But let's look at the example here. So let's assume that the population consists of 845 employees, and we want to take a sample of 52. Well, when you're looking at a random number table, such as Appendix B6 in your textbook here, the first thing you do is you find a starting point. And that starting point could be, you know, just you point your finger, you throw a dart, whatever it happens to be. And then once you've found your starting point, you decide what direction you're going to go. You're either going to go up, to the left, to the right, whatever it happens to be. Usually you would go down or to the right. So in this case, we have picked a starting point here, and you'll see that there's more than 3 digits here, but we only have, you know, 845, so we only need to use the first 3 columns of numbers. So with the starting point here, we see that the first number that we've selected is employee number 37. We've decided to go to the right. So the next one is employee number 447. Now you'll notice that the next column, it isn't grayed out there because we're not selecting that because there is no employee 961. So we just skip over that one, go to the next one, and we do 784, go to the next one, 189. And so we continue on until we have all 52 employee numbers selected. If the three digits are not valid, like 999 or 961, we just skip over and go to the next one. And that's how easy it is to use a random number table to select which members of the group will be surveyed. Now, of course, we can also generate random number tables using the rand function in Excel, or there's also the sampling function that's part of the data analysis. And so the next couple of the slides, we'll discuss how to use the data analysis sampling feature. So with the example given to us here, we have a bed and breakfast, we have 30 days in June, and we want to select some rooms at random, or some nights at random, and kind of see what the average might be for the month. Before we actually discuss the Excel command, we need to talk about two different kinds of sampling. There's sampling with replacement and sampling without replacement. Now, in sampling with replacement, you pick the one that you've sampled and you put it back in the list so it could be selected again, like the example here of a catch and release fish. Now, in sampling without replacement, once we take the item out and survey it or test it, it's not going back in, hence the fish that are on the stringer. They're not going back in. We cannot catch them a second time. Excel, with the function you're about to see, the two functions you're about to see, does use sampling with replacement. So the same number may pop up more than once. If so, and you didn't want to survey it again, you would just ignore it. But you'll see that in this next slide. There's two approaches that we can take to simple random sampling in Excel. One would be what you see at the top right of the slide here. That is the rand between function. We could just do equals rand between 1, 30, between 1 and 30. It'll give us a random number in that range. However, if you do use that more than once, you could end up with the same number appearing twice. And if that's the case, you would just ignore it and execute the command a second time or third time or whatever it happens to be. That's because it uses sampling with replacement. Now the other example that we see with the sampling dialog box, that's available in the data analysis. Remember, you do have to turn that on. That's an add-in. If it isn't on, we discussed that earlier in earlier lessons here. But you would just select the input range of what days you wanted selected here. And in this case, you can see that that would be the days of June 1 through 30, and so we specify those cells as the input range. Then we do select random, the little checkbox there that you see it says random, and we put in the number of samples we're looking for, which is 5. And finally, we select an output range, and when we click OK, we have 5 random days selected for it. So it's very easy to do using the random number table, using the rand between function, or using the sampling feature in Excel's data analysis. Well, the simple random sampling, remember we just had random numbers and we picked them by random numbers. There's also something called systematic random sampling. That's basically where you find a starting point and you pick every nth member, like every third member, every fifth member, every seventh member. And there's actually some formulas that you use to compute how many members you should skip over. In other words, whether it should be every third member, every fifth member. And you'll see that formula here on the next slide. So with the example given to us in the book, we have an N, or the population. Notice that's capital N. Remember, that's always population. And we want the sample size, lowercase n, to be 52. So we're going to calculate the K, which is how many persons we should skip over. So K is simply going to be the big N, capital N, the population size, divided by the little n, the sample size. So in this case, 16. So we're going to select every 16th member to sample. There's some other methods of sampling that you'll read about in your textbook, but we'll go ahead and skip them in this slide presentation. But the next concept that we need to talk about is sampling error. And sampling error is the difference between a sample statistic and the corresponding population parameter. Remember, we use the term parameter to refer to population. We use the term statistic when we're referring to a sample. So the difference between X bar and mu, remember X bar is a sample mean, and mu being the population mean, would be the sampling error. And so we also see the variance, the standard deviation, and also the probabilities. So the difference between what we end up with our sample and the population is called the sampling error. We've used the term distribution a couple of times. We've talked about frequency distribution, we've talked about probability distribution, and now we're talking about the sampling distribution of the sample mean. Now the sampling distribution of the sample mean is a probability distribution consisting of all the possible sample means that we could get. And as you'll see here, this could get really, really out of hand in a hurry if you're dealing with a large sample size and a large population. But it is every possible sample mean that you can have. So let's go through an example of what we're talking about, the sample distribution of the sample mean. So this particular company has 7 production employees, and they're listed here, and these are the hourly earnings of those employees. So what we want to figure out here is what's the population mean, and we want to figure out what is the sampling distribution of the sample mean for a sample size of 2. And we'll also find out what is the mean of the sampling distribution, and we'll go ahead and do some other things as well. All right, the first thing we wanted to do is figure out what the population mean was. That's very easy. We simply add them all up and divide by the N, population size. We end up with a population mean of $7.71. Then we also want to do the sampling distribution of the sample mean. And the first thing we need to figure out is how many possible samples of 2 there are. Well, to do that, we use the combination formula, and you can see the formula listed there. That tells us that there are 21 different combinations from an n, a population size of 7, and a lowercase n, a sample size of 2. We can also use the Excel formula, the COMBIN, and there you see it used with the 7, 2, and that will also give you the 21. So here you see a sampling distribution of the sample means of a population of 7 and a sample size of 2. And so here are the 21 combinations that we can have. If we pull a sample size of 2, we could have Joe and Sam, Joe and Sue, Joe and Bob, and so on. And you can see that this could become very unwieldy if you're dealing with a large sample size and a large population. But it is an important concept, so we'll go ahead and continue with this. Right, so here we see the sampling distribution of the sample means in a different way. We actually see the number of times each mean has occurred, and then we have a probability distribution. And the reason we're doing that is we want to illustrate a very important point on the next slide. All right, now we're finally getting to the point of all this. The sampling distribution of the sample means, notice that when we graph out the distribution of the different means occurring, that on the right, it is a little bit more normal, approaches a normal distribution more so than the population itself. And this is a very, very important concept. It's telling us here that the sampling distribution of the sample means is closer to normal than the population. That's going to make a whole lot more sense as we continue on with the next couple of slides here. All right, so here we go. This is where we've been heading, and that is the central limit theorem. And the central limit theorem tells us that if all samples of a particular size are selected from any population, the sampling distribution of the sample mean is approximately a normal distribution. So let me read the little bullet points here just because this is an important point. For any sample size, the sampling distribution of the sample mean will also be normal if the population is normal. But if the population is symmetrical but not normal, the normal shape begins to appear with a sample size as small as 10. And if the distribution is skewed, the population distribution, it may require a sample size of 30 or more. So basically what this tells us is that no matter what the population looks like, no matter how it's distributed, if we get a sample size of 30 or more, we can assume that our sampling distribution of the sample mean is normally distributed. And the reason that's important is many of the tests that we're going to be working with, we've already talked a little bit about the z-test, we'll continue more with that, but we're going to be talking about t and f. It assumes that our data is normally distributed in the sample, and the central limit theorem allows us to make that assumption. So this slide just shows us a little bit about how the central limit theorem works graphically. So the larger our sample size, the more the distribution approaches normal with the sampling distribution of the sample mean. There's another term, another formula we're introducing you to you here. It's called the standard error of the mean, and it's based on the concept that the larger your sample size, the smaller the difference will be between the actual population mean and the sample mean. But the formula that you can see here, the standard error, which is really the standard deviation of the sample mean, is the sigma, the standard deviation of the population, divided by the square root of n, which in this case, lowercase n, so that means the sample size. Well, in the next couple of slides, we're actually going to show you an example of how we actually use sample means. And so in order for us to do this, we have to know sigma. And sigma, in this case, is going to be the standard deviation of the population. So we have a formula here down at the bottom of the slide where you can see we're going to be computing a z based on the sampling mean. So we have the sample mean minus mu divided by the standard deviation of the population, which is also divided by the square root of n. And we'll actually see how this works, and it actually allows us to use our sample and predict how close our sample is to the actual population mean. Okay, so here we have an example. So we have the Cola Company has historically discovered that the mean amount for bottle is 31.2 ounces. That's the population mean. The population standard deviation is 0.4 ounces. So in order to solve this with the formula that we saw, remember we have to know what the population mean is, and of course the population standard deviation. So at 8 o'clock today, they randomly selected, and that's key, randomly selected, that's the method of sampling that they use, 16 bottles, and they found out that the mean of the sample size of 16 was 31.38. So they want to know, is this within their tolerances? So they'd like to know, what is the probability of getting that sample size? So we're going to go ahead and run through some formulas here and see if they have a problem or they don't have a problem with their bottling machine. So running through the numbers that we've got with the X bar and the mu and the standard deviation and the sample size, we end up with a Z value of 1.8. So now we're going to figure out what the probability of getting a Z of 1.8 actually is. if it's within the tolerances of that particular machine is what we're trying to determine here. All right, we found a z of 1.8, and so we're trying to figure out what is the probability of getting a z which is greater than or equal to 1.8. And so using the table, we find out that the probability associated with 1.8 is 0.4641. Well, what does that actually mean? Well, let's go to the next slide and see. Okay, just a quick reminder, when we look up a probability for a z-value, in this case 1.8, and we ended up with 0.4641, remember that's the position from the mean over to the actual z-value. So the probability, or the area under the curve, from the mean to the z of 1.8 is 46.41%, which leaves 0.0359% of the area under the curve greater than or equal to that. So basically what that means is there's a less than 4% chance of getting a sample that has that particular mean with a z of 1.8. So here's the conclusion. It's unlikely, less than a 4% chance, that we would select 16 observations from the sample and end up with the mean of 31.2. So that tells us that the machine is probably broken. It's way out of tolerance. It's putting in too much cola within the bottles. 96% chance that it should be lower than that. We have less than 4% chance that it's higher than that. So we're out of tolerance.